My name is Rita McLaughlin. I am an elementary music teacher at Lowell's Merklin School. Before I describe my journey from the Royal Palace to the circus, I would like to just give you a little bit of background. So, if I click here, I think, okay. So, a few years ago, I was invited by Johanna Segerich and Donna Cady from Middlesex to work on a previous grant that Middlesex Community College got called Preserving Cambodian Classical Music. And they approached me one day and said, hey, we want you to teach a course for Lowell teachers about Cambodia because you went there before. I'm like, I can't do that. I did travel in 2008 to Vietnam and Cambodia through primary source in Watertown through a Lowell grant by the Parker Fund, funded by the Parker Foundation. And so I knew something of the history and culture from that tour. And since then I had been working with Cambodian colleagues to teach my students some simple folk songs, Cambodian singing games, and simple dances. But it turned out this was an invitation for me to meet Master Song Heng, and this has changed my life and my teaching. So for 2 years we worked with Song Heng, and we offered in the first year a graduate course through Fitchburg State University now for Lowell's teachers, and we worked with him weekly for an extra long semester from January through May. And for 6 weeks we're introduced to these, we thought, oh, we're musicians, this is gonna be great, we'll just learn. But it was really a big paradigm shift because we had to put away everything we'd done. We learned music from notation, we learned to interpret. And we just needed to have Song play a little melody and then try to remember it, you know, when he walks away. And it took a long time for us to shift into rote learning. And after about 6 or 8 weeks, we had been trying to notate, record, whatever we could, take pictures. Finally, we put it all away. All about the same time, we said, oh, we can do this. And we let go and went with the journey, and it was amazing. This picture is a group from the second year when we had monthly workshops, and it culminated last spring in a public performance at the Stockless School. And because we had some returning musicians and some new musicians, we were able to play different groups and play three different songs. So we played a folk song, children's song, Sari Kakao. We also performed part of the blessing dance, and I think Bopa Lokea, Dance of the Flowers. This is a recording of, it's not our final performance, it's far less polished, but it's important because it was the first time that in the first group we were able to actually play our section of the blessing dance from beginning to end. And I'm not gonna play the whole thing for you, but I want you to listen because I'm gonna tie it back in at the end. What you'll notice is, or you may notice, is that the traditional music that we learned to play on the pimpi, we're all playing different instruments, is really a series of short motifs that are repeated. So it's kind of like a formal rondeau, or a little advanced rondeau. We had the tao, which is the repeated section, sort of the refrain, we would call it, and it has a little motif, you repeat it, you play a first ending, you repeat it, play a second ending, then we do section one, repeat it, first ending, second ending, go back to the tao, and it just goes back and forth. And so this later on was, you know, something I could work in from the circus music. So I'll play a little bit for you here. I think if I do this, you'll hear the beginning, and then I'm gonna show you Song's big smile at the end when we actually got to the end this time.
Thank you.
we really felt like, oh, we can play together now. But I was realizing already that we were spent, this is, after 2 years, I had spent a lot of time with song. We had this group go home, and then the community musicians stayed, and I was so obsessed that I would really be there from about 3 to 8 or 9 o'clock, just trying to learn as much as I could from him. But I, while we had him there, but I realized I have only 4 melodic instruments and some drums and shing, and I have 500 students in groups of 25 classes, 25 students in a class for 50 minutes once a week. We don't have the time, and these children are young, to do this. So what am I going to do with that? So this is what I was exploring and hoping to find some inspiration during our tour. So I'm going to continue. I think I can come over here now. So let's see what this is. So what I proposed, some research to go to Cambodia for the second grant, Cambodia's Cultural Heritage in the Modern World. I was thinking still in terms of, what about this Pinpi? What are the modern teaching practices there? Are people using electronic, you know, devices like we were to record, or are they just strictly doing rote teaching? What is the accessibility for youth, especially children who are underprivileged? I understood from my research there are a lot of schools that offer free lessons, so I wanted to see this for myself. What are the notation and archiving processes going on at the universities, and gender roles? We asked Song at one point, Song, when we go there and they see women playing pinpi, you know, are they going to think this is great? They said, oh yeah, there are a lot of women. And then he said, well, maybe some. Well, maybe none. So we said, okay, well, but he said, they're going to love it. You're playing our music and you're excited. So, and just personal curiosity, will anybody even recognize 6,000 miles away these melodies that I'm trying to play? So before I went, most of my questions were kind of already answered because there's a lot on the internet. And within a week or so, I kind of could have just, you know, spoken to each of these. So what about the rest of the trip? What am I going to do afterward with my 500 students? Because I have curriculum already, and I can't just teach Khmer music. I have children speaking 23 languages at the Merklin School right now from many cultures around the world. And I have curriculum, notation and folk dance. So what are we going to do? So some of the experiences that shaped my thinking, I started to see throughout many visits that there was a contrast. And I started to think about the title of this grant, Preserving Cambodia's Cultural Heritage in the Modern World. What can I do to honor these traditions and preserve them and teach respect for these traditions? Because they've basically been unchanged for hundreds or thousands of years. People are playing these same melodies by rote. And what else can I do so that my students don't look at those instruments and think, well, that's like Mozart and Beethoven, all the composers are dead. That's something people did a long time ago. We have to make them modern and make sure that they are relevant instruments and not relics. So I had this sort of conflict. So we saw many examples every single day about how these ancient traditions are being preserved, but also joyfully transformed into modern music. We saw up here these, I don't know, whoops, how to do, what is the middle one? Is the laser? I don't see it.
The button at the top.
Okay, let me, I'll get this. All right. So, there we go. So this instrument, this was its debut when we were there at the William University of Fine Arts. It's a type of harp that had only been seen in carvings at the temples. And someone said, well, what are these instruments? And so someone decided to build one, and they were trying to, these girls I talked to, so there's the gender role. Plenty of girls are, you know, traditionally were dancers. The men played the instruments and the girls danced. But these girls were among many at the university, freely able to pursue music instruction if they wanted. And I asked them, well, what music are you playing if these are ancient instruments and no one's seen them? And she said, well, we just took some of the melodies from our other ones and we're playing them here for now. So that is improvisation. Here's an ancient instrument, what do we do with it now? We just play whatever, you know, whatever we think would be relevant there, and they're loving it. This young man is playing here. Let's see my laser again. All right, this young man is playing the tro'o, another traditional instrument, but all the rest of the instruments in that ensemble, they're a modern string ensemble. They're playing violin and cello, and they're incorporating the tro'o in that. I've been talking with Gina Greer at UMass Lowell, and she's planning to do that now, to incorporate the strings into the ancient strings, the tro'o, into the University of Lowell's string project, which is award-winning across the country. They are teaching, they're outreaching to Lowell's youth to teach them strings through low-cost instruction, the violin, viola, cello. So she's going to be incorporating that hopefully within the next year or so, and I'm going to work with her on this. we've got archiving. I mean, there's plenty of archiving going. People in Cambodia have modern technology, and so there is a really urgent sense of trying to record as much of these music from people who remember it before their lives are finished, so that we can carry it into the future. At the Royal Palace, these men, there would happen to be one instrument empty, so I hopped in and played. And they saw me and sit down, and they started playing "When the Saints Go Marching In." So I laughed and I waited. Mm-hmm. And then when they finished, I started playing "Gopal Ok, Dance with the Flowers," and they looked surprised for a second, and they jumped right in and played. Within about a minute, I could not keep up with them, but at least they recognized my music, and they are also using, obviously, these instruments to play modern music to entertain. So they're doing both. Cambodian Living Arts has a big, long history. We saw, again, the traditional instruments, and these might be recordings, I think. So, good, still here. So we're having the master classes, the traditional music is preserved. Everywhere we went, we saw this, but we also see on the right, students were demonstrating after the traditional dances, then they're demonstrating a modern dance, the Saravam, which is often performed at weddings and celebrations. And so this is a beautiful video to show my children, because that's a new dance that I can incorporate instead of the old dances. So I'm really bad at this. So let me go back to, so you can see this. Okay, sorry. What do I do for the next 3 weeks? Where do I go from here? That I was thinking these questions. How am I going to maximize exposure to the Pimpin so it's not taken out for 6 weeks while we learn about Khmite and then tucked away and covered with dust covers the rest of the year while I'm teaching my other curriculum? How can I remain culturally sensitive to preserve the traditions but also help the students to make connections to their music today? So this brought to mind the monkey dance. In Lowell, the Angkor dance troupe has beautiful costumes, meticulous attention to detail in the traditional dance. But after halfway through, the music morphs into some hip-hop style, and the monkeys are doing hip-hop dancing and flipping, and the kids love it. And so they've been able to make this ancient dance relevant to today's youth. They can't wait to try it. And so I had to think, what can I do with my instruments in my classroom, something along that vein, and how much leeway do I have, to kind of make a change without being disrespectful? That's what I was thinking. So we move on. I'm not going to talk to these. Some of these people really had influence. I don't want to talk too long. I guess basically here's the contrast. Two people that we met on the same day, Yuk Chen. Did I say his name right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. He makes his living documenting difficult work, documenting thousands and thousands of, tens of thousands of documents, 6,000 pictures, and his life's work is documenting the genocide and seeking justice. Yet he said, and I think we all wrote this down, but I'm living my life today. Don't call me survivor. I am Yuk Chen. He showed us the whole building he had